Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Case Western Reserve University, welcome to the Maltz Performing Arts Center. I'm Brian Amkraut, the Executive Director of the Laura and Alvin Siegal Lifelong Learning Program at Case Western Reserve University, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our special evening with New York Times columnist Roger Cohen. I do want to take a few minutes to talk a little bit about our program, thank a few people, and then tell you a little bit about Roger, and then we'll get going. The Siegal Lifelong Learning Program connects the university, which includes our full-time faculty and our invited guests, such as Roger, with the general community. We are committed to offering accessible learning opportunities, both for personal enrichment and professional advancement, with the same commitment to the highest educational quality that Case Western Reserve University is so well known for. Our program reflects the breadth of content that comes out of a major research university, which means we run the gamut from arts and music programming to science and medicine, from one-shot lectures on current events to 24-week boot camps in computer coding and data analytics. And if we don't have what you're looking for, please let us know. We should be able to find some programs that align with your needs and interests. So one upcoming program note, this Thursday in Beechwood, we welcome presidential historian Robert Watson from Lynn University in Florida. Some of you remember Robert was here last summer talking about Hamilton. This week, he's going to discuss President Truman, so real breadth of scholarship there. We want to thank the Moskowitz family for hosting Roger this evening and sponsoring the reception we just held prior to tonight's program. And not only the reception, we can say all of tonight's program is dedicated to the memory of Dr. Raleigh Moskowitz, who was a major figure in the local community, including being on the faculty here at Case Western Reserve University. And Raleigh passed away just over 2 months ago, and his presence this evening is sorely missed. We also note the recent passing of our program's major benefactor, Alvin Siegal. His vision, along with his wife, Laura, to establish a robust continuing education operation continues to inspire us. His loss is also profoundly felt. In the last 6 years, since our program began at Case Western Reserve, we've grown from serving just under 2,000 people to now reaching nearly 5,000 constituents annually, with over 250 program opportunities in any given year. We continue to grow our offerings to represent the university most effectively and to serve the needs of our constituents of learners here in Northeast Ohio. And our success is largely due to your ongoing interest. We are extremely fortunate here in Greater Cleveland to have such a highly engaged and intellectually curious community. And our program exists to serve you, and we thank you for your ongoing support for our work. I also want to thank our small but highly dedicated staff for their commitment until fulfilling our mission. And special thanks to President Barbara Snyder and our new Provost Ben Vinson III for their advocacy of lifelong learning and everything they do for the community at Case Western Reserve University and throughout the region. Please, thank you. Tonight, we welcome back to Cleveland New York Times columnist Roger Cohen. I believe Roger was actually our first invited guest speaker under our new structure as the Siegal Lifelong Learning Program. And if you look at the news in the last 6 years, of course, what a change can bring, that time can bring. I believe when Roger was here last, he was speaking about the Arab Spring. And we were contemplating the impact of that development as potentially ushering in a radical shift in geopolitics. And certainly it would have been very hard at that time to envision the way our domestic and international politics have actually unfolded during the interim, but here we are. And on that note, let me say a little bit about Roger. He joined the New York Times in 1990, was a foreign correspondent for more than a decade before becoming acting foreign editor on September 11, 2001, and foreign editor 6 months later. Since 2004, he has written a column for the International New York Times, formerly known as the International Herald Tribune, and in 2009, he was named as a columnist for the New York Times. He has written Hearts Grown Brutal, Sagas of Sarajevo, which is an account of the wars of Yugoslavia's destruction. He has written Soldiers and Slaves, American POWs Trapped by the Nazis' Final Gamble, and has also co-written a biography of General H. Norman Schwarzkopf titled In the Eye of the Storm. His family memoir, The Girl from Human Street, Ghosts of Memory in a Jewish Family, was published in January 2015. Roger was raised in South African England and is now a naturalized American, perhaps now wondering what that means in today's environment. Please note that following his formal remarks, we will be taking questions from the audience, so please find one of the microphones that will be brought to the aisles. Please welcome me in joining, and please join me in welcoming Roger Cohen.
Thank you very much, Brian. One of the things about being a columnist is when you get something wrong, it's a pretty public thing. The Arab Spring did look pretty good for a while. I would like to echo Brian's words and dedicate my speech tonight to the memory of Rolly Moskowitz, married for more than four decades to my cousin Peter Moskowitz. Peter and her daughter Cara are here tonight. Rolly was an inspiration to me, and I think to many of you, a man of infectious, positive spirit, a man who wore his great learning and his very distinguished career very lightly. And I know that he would very much have appreciated this evening bringing together in one place a great place of learning and higher education, Case Western, a Jewish setting. This would have meant a lot to Rolly. Like Peter, I'm one of a gang of South African Jews who fanned out across the world. And I think we carry some kind of positive spirit with us, perhaps, even in these difficult times, because present in my life, and I know Peter's, there was always the possibility of imminent catastrophe. The 4 million whites of South Africa lived in a state of constant precariousness. It was inevitable, as my cousins would tell me, next year the swimming pools will be red with blood. I remember hearing that so many times in Houghton. And the blacks, repressed and banished to the horizon and the fetid townships there beyond the horizon, would inevitably rise up and claim that was what was theirs and seek vengeance for the cruel injustices of apartheid. Well, as you know, it never happened. It never happened thanks to the statesmanship of, quaint word, statesmanship, we've almost forgotten it. It would be good to revive it. The statesmanship of Nelson Mandela and de Klerk. And I've never forgotten that. I'm sure Peter never hasn't. Whatever the acute social problems of South Africa today, to me, the glass is always half full. You know, I was looking at my title tonight, Crisis Without Catastrophe, Mysteries of Trump World, and there's that word catastrophe again, and I was thinking maybe I was a little optimistic in my title. Sometimes of late, it has felt pretty close to catastrophe, but I remain at heart an optimist and a great believer in this country. And we meet tonight at a great university. A liberal arts education is a great thing. Never underestimate the privilege of receiving it. It can open eyes, it can change a life, it can bring home the sacredness of truth, it can teach, should teach, open debate. No society can be healthy without the capacity for civilized disagreement. And sometimes I fear we're losing that in the United States today. And it can help consolidate your moral being. Your moral being, that's really the heart of it. The Trump presidency is my subject, and we meet today at one of those turning points in the life of the Republic. Who could watch last week that pouting, elaborately coiffed man standing at a podium behind the seal of the President of the United States of America, mocking the survivor of a sexual assault, and not feel nausea? I don't like to use that word, but I think it is appropriate. Nausea, la nausée in French, as you may know, was the title of a novel written in the 1930s by Jean-Paul Sartre, one of whose main themes was that life is meaningless without personal commitments that give it meaning. And who could watch those cheering, riveted Americans in the backdrop to President Donald Trump and not feel disquiet, some faint echo of the 20th century's darkest hours? And who could not be reminded again of Benjamin Franklin's words in 1787 when asked what form of governance had been adopted for the nascent United States? A republic, if you can keep it. A republic, if you can keep it. And we are engaged today in the keeping of it. President Trump has taken a sledgehammer to America's moral core. This, as a naturalized American, is what I believe. I will not shut up, as Steve Bannon once urged the press to do, nor will my colleagues at what President Trump likes to call the failing fake news New York Times. In fact, we've added 1 million digital subscriptions since he took office. Thank you for that, Mr. President. The Brett Kavanaugh hearings before the Senate Judiciary Committee have been a Rorschach test for America's tribes. They saw what they wanted to see. For Kavanaugh's supporters, his rage was as good a primal scream for threatened white male privilege as may be imagined. For me, Christine Blasey Ford's 100% rang more true than Kavanaugh's. This was not a criminal trial. If I'd been on a jury, I couldn't have said beyond a reasonable doubt that he was guilty. But it was a job interview, and he failed the job interview, in my view. Who wanted this injudicious man, this angry man, occupying a place for life on the highest court in the land? Well, ladies and gentlemen, tens of millions of Americans did, and this is where we are. There's not much common ground left in the country, and truth is under assault. Hannah Arendt wrote that the ideal subject of totalitarian rule is not the convinced Nazi or the convinced communist, but people for whom the distinction between fact and fiction, i.e. the reality of experience, and the distinction between true and false, i.e. the standards of thought, no longer exist. Well, since he took office, according to that other newspaper, the Washington Post, Donald Trump has issued more than 4,200 false or misleading claims. That's about 7 a day. So falsehood is now the standard fare of Americans. I don't think there's anything accidental about this or about the president's intentions, which are to foster disorientation. Disorientation favors autocratic rulers who want to portray themselves as the sole font of truth. Remember Donald Trump at the Republican convention in 2016. I am your voice. The United States has had some pretty bad presidents, but I don't think we've ever had a president who keeps telling Americans they cannot trust the institutions that form the checks and balances that are the foundation of our republic. Don't trust a free press, it's fake. Don't trust the judiciary or the Justice Department or even my Attorney General. It has a hostile agenda. Just trust me. This message emanates in various forms almost daily from the White House. And I think we're being invited to tumble down some rabbit hole where 2 + 2 = 5. Take the word honesty itself. There are now two definitions of truth in the United States of America. The first, and I imagine it's the one that in this place of higher learning is more generally favored by all of you, and that is that a truthful statement is one that conforms to the facts. Well, by that standard, President Trump is a serial liar. The second is that truth is telling it like it is, or speaking in a direct, unvarnished way without regard to political correctness. By this measure, for his supporters, Trump remains the most honest president that we've ever had. And I've heard this many times. He tells it like it is. He does what he said he would do. He moved the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. He trashed the nuclear accord with Iran. He pulled out of the climate accord in Paris. He does what he said he would do, unlike most politicians. He's the most honest president we've ever had. Now, of course, America needs the conversations across ideological lines that it's not having. It's become axiomatic to say, and we're all in our ideological silos or chasms, and we can't speak to each other. And in part, I think the country's not having them because it's difficult even to agree on language any longer. I just cited honesty, two different definitions. We don't have much of a shared lexicon. Climate change, sustainability, justice, self-reliance, gender, coal, guns, God, the new verb to me too. Words like these are now tribal detonators, badges of identity about which discussion has become near impossible. Tolerance and restraint are essential ingredients of democracy, but they're drowned out more and more often, day by lying day. I firmly believe that beyond all his military bluster, the most dangerous assault from President Trump is on truth itself. It's hard to remember Friday what you were outraged by Monday. Outrage fatigue sets in, we're human. I recall the first time that I shrugged. It was when President Trump said that he'd had phone calls from the head of the Boy Scouts and the president of Mexico, and they'd called to congratulate him, of course, on something or other. Only thing was, then, the president of Mexico and the head of the Boy Scouts said, well, no, actually, we never called the president. There was no such phone call. And then Sarah Huckabee Sanders was asked in the White House whether the president had lied about this. And she said, and I remember listening to her, she said, no, I wouldn't really exactly say it was a lie. No, it wasn't. I mean, he got it a little bit wrong, but it wasn't. And, you know, I confess, I own up, ladies and gentlemen, I did shrug. It had become, at that point, so common for this kind of thing to happen that I shrugged. And I would say to you, please, ladies and gentlemen, don't shrug. Don't shrug. Don't start shrugging, because down that road lies nothing good. And I think what our president is drawn to is no secret. He models his New York apartment on Versailles, the palace where these words are emblazoned: Le roi gouverne par lui-même. The king governs by himself. L'état, c'est moi. The state is me. Xi Jinping turns himself into an emperor for life in China, and our president suggests we should try that sometime. He says that when the North Korean leader Kim Jong-un, who's now a great personality, speaks, his people sit up to attention. And he says, I want my people to do the same. Now, it would be easier to dismiss these as throwaway lines, as attempts at jokes, or even jokes, if it were not for the fact that from his first trip overseas, that Saudi love fest, until today, the president's attraction to dictators has been very consistent, and his disdain for democratic leaders like Angela Merkel equally so. I would say this is a president who tends to favor many of America's foes over its friends. His means is untruth, his aim is political, but there's a deeper thing going on: the dismantlement through repetitive falsehood of moral beings. Well, you might say, all well and good. Typical New York Times drivel, liberal moaning. Who cares about truth when you can't pay for health care and your school district is crumbling because all the factories have closed and the tax base is gone? Almost 2 years of Trump. The world has not gone over a cliff. The economy is up. We like the look of our 401ks. full employment. All the noise is just a distraction. It's harmless enough in the end. It's a camouflage behind which he gets things done. You liberals, you New York Times people with your environmental concerns, how about the jobs lost when a coal-fired power plant shuts down? You suffer from a contempt problem. That's why you lost in 2016. You know, nobody ever had their minds changed by being made to feel stupid. You know, you New York Times people, Donald Trump thinks white lives matter too. Why can't you white liberals see that and appreciate that? And so on, and so on, and so on. Well, as readers of my column know, I have been critical of Democratic Party contempt, the strange, largely unexplained inability of the party to connect with small town and rural America, with working and middle class Americans. Trump identified and became the voice of an anger and frustration in the country that was and remains real. That's why he's in the White House. But to dismiss him as innocuous, to play down the damage he's doing just because war has not broken out with Iran or North Korea or the Baltics, is, I think, dangerous. And that's why I hesitated when I looked again at my title, Crisis Without Catastrophe. Look at just what happened in Istanbul with Jamal Khashoggi, a dissident Saudi journalist, very well known in Washington circles. As you know, he walked into the Saudi consulate to get a document signed, and he disappeared. And there are insistent accounts that he has been murdered by Saudi agents. Well, look what just happened to Victoria Marinova, a journalist in Bulgaria, who had been critical of the regime and was just brutally murdered. The fact is that our president, the president of the United States, is empowering such people. His initial embrace of Mohammed bin Salman, the crown prince who is effectively running Saudi Arabia, was so fulsome that, in effect, MBS, as he's known, feels empowered to do what he likes. If he has indeed arranged for the killing of Jamal Khashoggi, I think he has seriously overstepped the mark. But this process is going on all around the world. I mentioned 1 million new subscriptions, but there's real damage to a free press around the world, possibly in countries with less strong institutions than ours, when the President of the United States identifies journalists all the time with fake news. I've heard it myself in my travel. Oh, you're a journalist, fake news. Fake news, right? There's danger in President Trump's ignorance. He was asked yesterday by a Brazilian journalist about the Brazilian election. He said, huh, what? A Fox News journalist followed up and said, you know, the election. He walked out. He knew nothing about it. And of course, in Brazil, we've seen another lurch toward rightist strongman politics. 3,000 children separated from their parents, undocumented migrants living and hiding in fear, the elevation of bigotry and xenophobia to acceptability. All this is very, very worrying. And above all, I would say, the devaluation across the world of America's word. I've been thinking in this context of the late Richard Holbrooke, diplomat, patriot, peacemaker, often just plain impossible guy. I don't know how familiar he is to you. The 20th century and its lessons are fading fast. I got to know Holbrooke in Bosnia, where I covered the war for a couple of years. It was a war he put an end to, a great American diplomatic achievement. In truth, that Bosnian peace of 1995 was ugly, a bitter compromise. But when you've seen the deaths of 100,000 people in Europe, an accord like Dayton that silences the guns is still precious. The perfect cannot be the enemy of the good. Holbrooke died 8 years ago, and I've just read in galley form George Packer's wonderful biography of him coming out in December, Our Man. And I was in tears at the end of it because I grasped how lonely Holbrooke, then the special envoy for Afghanistan and Pakistan, had been. His private life in turmoil,
mistrusted by and estranged from the Obama administration. But above all, and this is what really got to me, I saw how his ideas about American power, about America's unique capacity to forge a more open and democratic world and stand for values of liberty and openness, a rules-based international order, the rule of law, how those ideas, even back then, were already becoming somehow quaint. Like the late John McCain, Holbrooke had lived through the zenith of post-war American power, had served in Vietnam, had no illusions about American failings, and yet always saw America's word as a pledge in the cause of liberty. And that, in the end, is what global security since 1945 rested on, America's word, the word given to allies in treaty commitments in Europe, NATO, Asia, Japan Alliance, and elsewhere. The credibility of that word, and I would argue its foundation in morality, that if any of those countries were attacked, America would feel itself attacked too and would come to their defense. And if I, a naturalized American, as I said, did not do what my uncle and father did, come from distant South Africa to join the war effort in Europe, the fight to preserve liberty, it was because of America's word. And I've tried throughout my life never to forget that. The United States is an idea, or it's nothing. When an American president dallies with dictators, scoffs at the American commitment to human rights, abandons a rules-based international order, treats alliances as zero-sum questions of cash, and devotes himself to blurring the distinction between truth and falsehood, America ceases to be. Hence, it should be no surprise that the end of the American century has coincided with the debasement of truth, the moment when America's word, as uttered by President Trump, became near worthless. Pax Americana died with the evisceration of America's word. May it rest in peace. It had a good run, and to those who say, Yankees get out, usually in my experience asking at the same time if one of those Yankees could take a child with them to get an education at a place like Case Western, I say, careful what you wish for. Of course, there is a bit of that structure left, and that, I think, is why we haven't gone over a cliff. The alliance, the NATO alliance, has not been torn up yet. I think, in addition, China, and of course the 21st century, will play out to a large degree through the prism of the American-Chinese rivalry and whatever that becomes. China wants stability. China has in mind 2050 and becoming a fully developed society by then. And so the Chinese don't want conflict. They don't want any kind of conflagration. And so I think whatever President Trump's acts of irresponsibility, and there have been many of them, the Chinese are not ready to jump on that. They are planning very carefully their growth to a fully developed country by the middle of this century. So I think that's an important reason why the world remains, despite this profoundly irresponsible American presidency, somewhat stable. I also think that the networks that link us all have an important role to play. I was in Hungary recently, and it struck me there was the newly nationalist, xenophobic, nativist leader of Hungary, Viktor Orban, talking about all these ideas and, you know, the decadence of the West and all the rest. And every Hungarian I met seemed to be Airbnb-ing his or her apartment to someone from Kazakhstan or from Sweden or from somewhere in Africa. And, you know, so there at the sort of political level was this message. And then the reality of people is that we are all networked, we are all connected. And the kinds of things that happened in closed societies in the 20th century, it's much more difficult for them to happen. 2018 has a lot that's bad about it, but we are not, in my view, in 1933. And of course, flux is in the nature of things. Even before Trump, even when Holbrooke died, the world had changed. China had risen, India's rising, Western democracy is in a state of upheaval. Technology has changed the world for good and ill. We like, we dislike, we follow, we unfollow, we broadcast our lives, we fall silent, adrenaline rushes, status anxiety ensues. In a way, contemporary life is an endless experiment in global direct democracy. We're networked. More than 2 billion people use Facebook. So do we really need representative democracy, which seems to be dysfunctional in many instances these days? Is it not just a means to give the powerful and the affluent the means to control our lives? This is a question that's being asked across the world, and it's an important question. But I don't think it should mask the fundamental fact that President Trump has empowered the likes of Vladimir Putin and Xi and Mohammed bin Salman, and so undercut the freedom on which any decent world must be built. Without decency, as Albert Camus noted, humanity is doomed. So, ladies and gentlemen, how did we get here? This is a strange moment. 5 decades after May 1968, almost 3 decades after the fall of the Berlin Wall, a great reactionary tide is unfurling. I didn't expect it. Perhaps none of us did. Brian alluded to the Arab Spring. I still believe Arabs need empowerment, need more representative government for their societies to flourish. But since that time, the tide has been flowing the other way. For a long time, it seemed that the spread, uneven and faltering, but pretty constant, of liberal democratic government, the rule of law, and pluralism would characterize our lives. No. Nationalism, nativism, xenophobia in various forms are on the rise. Liberal democracy itself, with its belief in openness, diversity, multiculturalism, is often derided. The forgotten people of globalization, those in the hinterland, what the French call the periphery, those whose world has remained local, those who want something different, who want disruption at any cost. That's what President Trump was about. That's what Brexit's about. That's what what's going on in Brazil is about. Have raised their voices to say enough. Well, enough of what exactly? I think enough of what intellectual and financial elites told them was acceptable and indeed inevitable in the age of Homo technologicus. Enough of precariousness. Enough of disappearing factories. Enough of obscene and growing inequality. Enough of the impunity of the powerful. Enough of great recessions for which nobody is to blame. Enough of cultural alienation. History, Trump voters have reminded us, can lurch. Certainly it doesn't glide to a curtainfall in a universal liberal democratic love-in. I don't believe it will be easy to dislodge Donald Trump from the White House. I believe the likelihood of a two-term presidency is real. All the noise he makes, all the foolish things he says and tweets, shouldn't mask the fact that he's a symptom, not a cause. He reflects and reinforces a global counter-revolutionary movement, a reaction to Chancellor Angela Merkel's cry that she was alternativlos, without alternatives. Well, the counter-revolutionaries say there are alternatives. Alternatives to openness, to mass migration, to free trade, to secularism, to Europe's ever closer union, to the legalization of same-sex marriage, to gender as a spectrum, to diversity, to Black Lives Matter, to Islam in Christian Europe, to renewable sources of energy, to permissiveness. They are angry, and they feel they have the wind at their back. Just look at Brazil, the world's fourth largest democracy. In the wired metropolis, the malcontents are not well understood in general, and mutual incomprehension characterizes our national fracture. Well, I've tried over the past 18 months. You know, you can sit in New York and go to dinners and compete for the funniest, best put down of President Trump. Actually, I heard a very good one the other day, which was that President Trump was in Helsinki meeting President Putin for the first time, and they strode toward each other and shook hands. And Putin said, "I'm Vladimir Putin, President of Russia." And Donald Trump said, "And I'm Donald J. Trump, President of the United States." "Oh," says Putin, "what does the J stand for?" And Trump says, "Genius." Yeah, well, you can have dinner after dinner in New York listening to that kind of thing. But I've tried to get out to Kentucky, Colorado, Arizona, Indiana, other places, because I think journalists, I've always believed, you know, phone calls, the internet, okay, but it's about boots on the ground. You know, it's about seeing, feeling, sensing, being there. You know, everything's changed in journalism, the way, everything. I started out filing by telex, except one thing: be there, bear witness, speak truth to power. Those things never change. And there's an ugly racist fringe to Trump support, very ugly, white supremacist, awful. There are also millions of decent, smart Americans who just view the world differently, who felt maybe they were losing some part of their country's essence as they see it, that Obama meant what he said in 2008 about fundamentally transforming the United States of America. Here's one voice I heard in Trump country: "People have to choose between heating their homes, buying food, or buying healthcare. And you want them to worry about the survival of the planet or transgender stuff? I respect business and I distrust government. That's the American way. I don't want illegal immigrants taking our jobs. I don't like liberals who shop at Whole Foods talking down their noses at me because I shop at Walmart. We lost our discipline and moral code in this country, so we need honest Trump to shake things up." And here's a Democrat in Colorado to whom I spoke. "Why am I a Democrat? I'm a Democrat because we need immigrants. There are farms around here that can't find a labor force thanks to Trump. I hate the idea of a wall. That's not what America's about. I'm a Democrat because I support Roe v. Wade. If you've seen a 13-year-old having a baby, and I did once as a hospital intern, that sets your feelings. Another reason I'm a Democrat is I can't stand the lying. I just wish Trump would tell the truth. The Republican Party, aka the Trump Party, has folded, said it's okay to lie. Tell me, what's the message there for our children?" But I'm also a Democrat, kind of disgusted with the Democratic Party. I guess that's what I really wanted to tell you. How can the party have lost touch so completely with how to talk to people in small towns across America? Take the environment. Like I said, my dad worked in the mines, so maybe that influences me. But you can't take jobs out of environmental concerns and give the impression you don't give a damn about creating new jobs. Around here, the Democratic Party is often seen as a job destroyer. Or healthcare, the number one concern of people around here. Around here, Obamacare is a disaster. The insurance companies have pulled out of rural areas, and when there's only one left, premiums go way up. Nobody can afford it. Some people are scared to get a job because they think they'll lose their Medicaid. It's screwed up, but the Democratic Party is too busy with its special interest groups, its gender spectrums, Me Too revolution to speak out about this kind of mess. You've got some of the worst funded schools in the country in this area. Some have gone to 4-day weeks because there's no tax money to support them, and it costs too much to run school buses. Imagine telling parents of kids in all those affluent metropolitan Democratic strongholds, "Sorry, 4-day school week." I can hear the collective outrage, but I don't see the Democratic Party owning the education issue. I thought the Democratic Party stood for social justice. Not really around here. My neighbors are Republicans, and that's how it is in small town America. It's tough to answer them when they say Democrats are taking our jobs, threatening to take our guns, our American self-reliance, and replacing it with handouts to every interest group with some gripe. Why have we Democrats let our founding American myths of can-do optimism, free speech, and individualism get away from us? I think that spells defeat. So that was what was going on in that guy's mind, and I think we need to think deeply and without illusions or arrogance about the chasm in this country. I don't like the word populism. I don't really use it. I don't like it because I think its meaning is kind of unclear, and it seems to me always to be freighted with contempt. And of course, this chasm is one to which Fox News, baleful thing, social media algorithms directing the stories that seem to the gods of Facebook to conform to the political inclinations you've manifested, bots and trolls, Republican debunking of reason and science, the money of Koch and Mercer, spreading technological autism. All this has contributed to these chasms, which need to be overcome. And I think the structures that preserve actual community and dignity among working class people, labor unions, for example, have been systematically eroded. There are places where there may be nowhere to work that is not shift work at a chain. And absent anything else, many blue-collar whites decided to unify around whiteness, and Trump became their mouthpiece. I think the Democratic Party has a lot of work to do ahead of 2020. We'll see how things come out next month. I certainly hope that the Democratic Party takes the House. I don't see it taking the Senate. But I think the party has to think very hard. I mean, there's a temptation to veer left, but I think it needs to think very hard about the working and middle class Americans who can be lured into abandoning Donald Trump through reasonable compromise. The liberal complacency that holds that Trump supporters just need to be educated is, I think, self-defeating. And I don't think coming across as just the party of angry, identity-obsessed interest groups, those gathered around race or sexual orientation, I don't think in the end it carries the day, and nor will mere Trump hatred. The same old won't work. Peter Drucker, a shrewd Dutchman, once observed, "The greatest danger in turbulent times is not the turbulence itself, but to act with yesterday's logic." We need to think again about liberal democracy. Tired formulas, nostalgia, commiseration won't help. Liberals can sometimes be bores. The Democratic Party needs to get out and work on core issues of health, education, energy, inequality. And I would look to purple state America, not blue state coastal America, for a candidate who's grappling with the country's toughest issues and is strong on can-do, down-to-earth values. Personally, I like John Hickenlooper, governor of Colorado, with whom I recently had a long conversation. Running a purple state, making compromises on energy and other issues, I think it's hard to grasp the truth. I'm sure it's easier in Ohio than it is in New York, but I think, you know, that is where I would look. And I like the words of Alexandra Arboleda, a lawyer friend in Phoenix who's a Democrat in a Republican county, who told me last year, "You have to be more receptive and see where people who don't think like you come from. Most people are concerned about climate change, and it's 88 degrees in October in Cleveland. But where in liberal Telluride that might be priority number one, with Republicans it's down the list. So you have to adjust. Instead of talking about sustainability and climate change, those detonating words that I mentioned, talk pragmatically about drought conservation plans. Persuade them that increasing irrigation efficiency at a time of the longest drought in recorded history on the Colorado River system benefits everyone from farms to downstream city users. It's doable. It's doable." Well, in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, you know Samuel Beckett's line, "Ever tried, ever failed, no matter, try again, fail better." I was thinking of it the other day in Athens when I was gazing at the Parthenon from the rooftop of the Hotel Grand Bretagne. And what came to my mind were the millennia, 2.5 millennia precisely in the case of Greece, of human striving for a political system permitting citizens to exercise power through their votes. Government of the people, by the people, for the people, as Lincoln put it. Try again, fail again, fail better. Thank you all for the act of civic faith in showing up here tonight. At its best, democracy is a culture that empowers citizens to participate in shaping their fates, in shaping their lives, and in living as free people. At its worst, it's a charade in which civic bonds erode, power accrues to the few, self-aggrandizement becomes the norm, and tolerance and restraint are consumed by the howling of the mob. It's Trump behind that seal of the President of the United States of America, baying, baying about a woman's suffering. That white citadel in Athens, like John Winthrop's City Upon a Hill, exhorts us as Americans to restore words like honor and decency. Let's be stubborn, very stubborn, about the sacredness of truth. There are those today on both sides of the Atlantic who are trying to turn the clock back to Europe's darkest hours, to true catastrophe. They're all about borders, real or imagined, against Islam, migrants and refugees, Jews, the European Union, the United Nations, George Soros. What they see is the pluralist international conspiracy. But let us never forget that it was precisely measures taken to construct or preserve a homogeneous society that lay at the core of the most heinous crimes of the last century, the catastrophes of the last century. Post-war Europe, anchored by American power, was erected to prevent their recurrence. The illiberal trend present in Europe and the United States today represents a rejection of the core post-war insight that ever closer union meant ever expanding peace. I don't think we can return to the 20th century. Closed societies are almost gone. The world, as I said, is networked, and on balance, those networks bring people together. We've learned that the networks can do other things. They can be used to repress, to disrupt democratic elections, as in 2016, and to damage free societies. But the freedom inherent in connectedness is, I believe, over time, stronger still. It's a reason why Trump has not been able to push the world over the brink, despite his bellicose instincts. We know too much, too fast, for that to be easily accomplishable. I believe, and here we get back to the optimism I spoke about at the beginning, that the United States, whatever its acute divisions today, is still the country of ex pluribus unum, and still a country where the president takes an oath, not to the people. And President Trump actually did say that he was taking an oath, in his inaugural speech, that he was taking an oath to the people. President takes an oath not to the people, who, as the founders knew, could become a mob, but to the Constitution. The rule of law is our North Star. We will guard and we will keep our republic, still an inspiration to free people the world over. In the end, as I said, I am an optimist. Democracy is resilient, it's stubborn, it raises our gaze. It's the system that best enshrines the unshakable human desire to be free. Athens reminds us of that. South Africa, which has just, despite much more fragile institutions, come through a Trump-like presidency with Jacob Zuma. Malaysia, Indonesia, remind us of that. The human urge to be free is not about to die in the 21st century. And deep in the roots of democracy, you find the human heart. You find the human conscience, and you find the core of human morality to which I alluded at the beginning. Dictatorships with their lies, their inhabitants, they are not citizens, their lies and their inhabitants disappearing in the night, they trample all this. Perhaps you know the story of the old man on his deathbed approached by his children. Dad, they say, we were afraid to ask you, but perhaps the time has come. Do you want to be buried or cremated. And the old man thinks for a long time, and then he says, "Oh, I don't know. Surprise me." American democracy will still surprise us. Difficult, angry days lie ahead. Very difficult days. And I think the Kavanaugh hearings suggested just how difficult. This president will not leave office without a very, very ugly fight. Don't believe for a moment that he will get bored of it or tired of it. He loves it. He loves seeing his name all over the place. That's what he lives for. Be constant. Be moral beings with a purpose that gives meaning to life. In conclusion, finally, I'd like to offer this reminder from a Polish poet, Czesław Miłosz, of the nature of totalitarian tyranny and the power of liberty, the written word, and the creative human spirit. "You who wronged a simple man, bursting into laughter at the crime, and kept a pack of fools around you to mix good and evil, to blur the line, though everyone bowed down before you, saying virtue and wisdom lit your way, striking gold medals in your honor, glad to have survived another day. Do not feel safe. The poet remembers. You can kill one, but another is born. The words are written down, the deed, the date. And you'd have done better with a winter dawn, a rope and a branch bowed beneath your weight." Thank you very much. And yeah, I'd be happy to take some questions if you have any. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for a fabulous talk. There was a report, I think, this week in your newspaper that we have until 2030 to address climate change. And it's entirely possible that Donald Trump will be president for more than half that time. So I'm wondering how it's possible to indeed remain optimistic in the face of that.
Well, as I said, I did hesitate over my title. And sometimes it is difficult. I think we all have moments when we feel deeply, deeply distressed and besmirched, really besmirched by what we see going on in the highest office in the land. President Trump does not believe in climate change. He doesn't change. I don't think anything will ever convince him of climate change because he knows. He just knows, and he doesn't read anything to speak of, so he's not going to change his mind. That said, the rest of the world is moving on, and the rest of the world includes places like the state of California, the state of Colorado. I don't know what's going on right here in Ohio. There are plenty of Americans and plenty of people with power in the United States of America who are not, just because Donald Trump doesn't believe in what is going on before our eyes, they're not going to stop the move toward renewables and sustainable energy sources and the move away from a fossil fuel economy. So, you know, I think that is a reason to have some degree of optimism about this. And of course, you know, countries around the world, the Europeans are doing a way, way, way ahead of the United States in these terms. And China is the largest electric car market in the world now, by far is China, and they're giving huge incentives to electric cars. I thought our lead story, my paper has done a fantastic job, but you know, sometimes the frustration you were just describing, ma'am, where did you go? There you are. You know, I can feel it, and I mean, our lead story today, it was like this. You know, here's this report, and President Trump was in Florida, and all things are happening with the sea level and flood. And he didn't say anything about it. It was a story about something that hadn't happened. You know, we had just turned it into, and the frustration of the journalist writing it was evident in the fact that this report, but there was no way the president was ever going to say anything about it. You know, I think we have to look reality in the eye. You know, we have to look reality in the eye. I think Trump supporters look reality in the eye. They know exactly who the president is. I mean, they know that he's a bad human being. I mean, they know that. They have no illusions about that. And some of the more religious of them say things like, well, in the past, you know, God has chosen non-believers to usher us to where we needed to go. So in other words, they wanted changes in the United States, and they have no illusions. And I don't think we should have illusions. He's not going to wake up one day and say, this is real and I'm going to do something about it. I think it's up to state governors and other people individually around the country to respond and to change the economy over time to curb carbon emissions. So I don't despair on that front. I think there are, Colorado, where I go quite a lot, there's a lot happening, a huge amount happening in California, on the West Coast in general. And you talk to governors of these states, they're not bowing and scraping to Donald Trump. Yes, sir.
I was struck by your discussion of Colorado because it reminded me of Peter Hessler's piece in The New Yorker about Grand Island, which people should look at. But I was also struck because you emphasized really Donald Trump and you emphasized certain voters. You emphasized certain voters, the white working class, you know, former Reagan Democrats or whatever. Yeah. But you didn't say much, only slightly referred to the whole structure of advocacy and building up of power, which is represented by things like the Federalist Society and the Koch brothers and so on.
Yeah.
And we talk about democracy, but there are these structures of power and of organization and of advocacy that have built up not out of, you know, legitimate misery about losing jobs, losing jobs, but for other reasons. And that strikes me as, and the Republican Party, arguably, not Trump, is in this sense the threat. And so I was wondering what you would say about that whole direction of the Republican Party, which is far precedes Trump.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think you're absolutely right, Sarah, and I think it's, you know, Citizens United, which you didn't mention, but which is part of this, and you know, the way people like the Koch brothers and Mercer are able to, you know, finance Breitbart, Fox News, and the way the spineless way in which the Republican Party has really just folded, in effect, to a charlatan. I don't think there's any easy or quick solution to all that. But you know, I still believe that maybe I'm starry-eyed, but I think Americans are fundamentally decent people, and that when there's a message that, as I said, raises their gaze a little bit, they can mobilize and they can act in ways that are even stronger than all that nefarious structure. Look at what happened with the Obama campaign in 2008. I mean, it was pretty remarkable, you know. I mean, there were kids out all around the country, and he won. And those structures, as you said, they long predate Trump. So, and I sense a United States that is extremely politicized right now, very, very politicized, particularly after what happened last week. And I think there are a lot of people who, including young people, who are angry, who are getting out there. You know, there are all kinds of theories both ways on what the effect of those hearings are going to be in terms of mobilization. I think we might get a higher turnout than we normally do in the midterms, and it'll be very interesting to see what happens. I worry about overreach from the Democratic Party if if indeed the Democrats take the House, because I think embarking on impeachment proceedings, which then don't lead to conviction because the Senate is Republican controlled, and then you have Trump going into 2020 as the victim or the acquitted guy, or I mean, look at the way he's already trying to manipulate what happened last week. I'm not sure that, in fact, I don't believe that's a good scenario. So it's a very, very delicate moment. And, there's no limit, I think, or very little limit to what, this president might try or might do. And as you noted, there's a lot of money behind it. But I don't think it's, I don't think the game's over. In terms of, the reforms that would be needed to change all that, with the Supreme Court having gone the way it's gone, it looks, when I think of my children and grandchildren, Kavanaugh's going to be there for, in all likelihood, for 30 years now. And the astonishing thing to me, or one of the many astonishing things about all that Lindsey Graham Republican outrage about, Merrick Garland, hang on a second. You guys stole a seat, You stole, flat out stole a seat, right, on the Supreme Court. And yet now you're outraged? Anyway.
You answered some of my question. I was going to ask about the Mueller investigation, because my guess is that many of us here have been hoping against hope that something would happen as a result of that. However, now with what's been going on after the Kavanaugh hearing and after his nomination and confirmation to the Supreme Court, I think there is grave concern that Sessions will be fired, Lindsey Graham will become the Attorney General, Mueller will be fired, and there will be no conclusion to this, and I wonder what your thoughts are.
That word catastrophe looms again. It's hard to read where the Mueller. I had a sense before the summer that it was building to its conclusion. That just receded. It feels like that's receded a little bit. My cousin Cara was saying maybe he's going to announce the conclusions, on November 2 or something, November 3. I have no kind of inside source on that. I mean, all I know is that my president's behavior with the president of Russia has been very, very strange. I don't get it. There's something there. There's some kind of kompromat, as the Russians call it. There's no way this bowing and scraping to President Putin from day one, this refusal to engage in even the mildest criticism, this outrageous sitting in Helsinki before the eyes of the world and saying, President Putin is more convincing to me than all my intelligence services on the intrusion in the 2016 election. I mean, this is crazy stuff, even by the standards of all the crazy stuff we live with day after day, which, as I said, makes it very hard to remember. The United Nations laughing at Trump, that seems like 6 months ago to me, what was it, 8 days ago or something, 9 days ago? In fact, the whole Kavanaugh thing, I was in New York where I live, and, there were all these world leaders, Macron, Merkel, Netanyahu, Mahmoud Abbas, they were all speaking away, and the UN General Assembly had just disappeared completely, and all eyes were on what was happening in the Senate Judiciary Committee. All that to say, I think Mueller will have something. What it is, whether that leads then to the president doing something rash, like pardoning his son-in-law or pardoning his some other family member, or even pardoning himself. He could do anything. It's very hard to read. I can't give you an informed answer, but I think there'll be something there. I assume we will, get it within the next 6 months, And then that will kind of set the scene, along with what happens in early November, for the next 2 years. I don't think we're going to see, a Trump impeachment. I would rule that out. And in a way, maybe that's really not a bad thing because, his base is still there. It's about 30% of the country, maybe a bit more. That's a lot of Americans, and they're already angry. And if they could even get more riled up. And, I think there's a reason why impeachment is difficult. I mean, democracy, you throw the bums out. That's how democracy works. And I remember in Egypt, when finally, all the people I'd stood in Tahrir Square with, and, finally Egypt had a free election. Lo and behold, the winner got 52% of the vote, not 98% like you always do in the Arab world. And he was a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, And then very quickly they started saying, we can't live with this, We've got to have a coup. We've got to throw him out. And I would say to them, you get to throw him out. 4 years from now, you throw him out. And of course, no, there was a coup. And then, of course, Sisi won the next election with 98% of the vote. And I do believe in the wisdom of voters, I mean, voters said something to all of us. They said something about things that were going wrong in this country. And that's why I say that a failure to, to look reality in the face and say, okay, they were saying something. So what were they saying and what could we do about it? And how can we beat this guy, in a very kind of hard-nosed, sometimes I feel that kind of reflection hasn't happened sufficiently. Yes, sir.
I think I'm next.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'd like you to comment on what I see and feel as a paradox. In a time of outrageous provocation cataloged by you about as well as I've heard anybody catalog the outrage and the provocation, it is absolutely critical that those of us who are not only optimists but centrists recognize the hazard of yielding to indignation. Because if you are suckered into indignation, you lose the calm and the perspicacity to try to inquire into where his support comes from. And until we can begin to understand that, we can't really respond deeply and intelligently. So we have a paradox that at a time when outrage feels appropriate, it is in fact the least appropriate thing, because we need to be calm and inquire carefully.
Oh, man. I like suckered into indignation. I may borrow that. That's pretty much, I think, what I just also tried to say in a slightly different way. I think, that's why you go out to Ohio or Colorado, or you go into Trump country and you try to listen to people. And, there's a values issue. Americans are never going to agree about guns. Never. I mean, there are issues about, on healthcare, on choice. There are a number of wedge issues. The thing is, these wedge issues have now become, they're very hard to debate. You could see, in my view, we need, very tough measures to restrict the use of guns in this country. I mean, there's a reason why these terrible things keep happening. But if you say to many, many, many millions of Americans, we're going to take your guns, so these are very, very difficult issues. And I don't think, there's a temptation, I think, in the, to respond, it's what you just said, to respond to Trump's anger with left-wing anger, with, you know, we need socialized medicine, or as the Republicans call it, or we need, you know, a welfare state in America. We need healthcare for everybody. You know, I don't think that you can't just make that fly from one day to another in this country. So, yeah, I as I've argued, I think we need. There was a message, you know. It's a wonderful thing, you know, that person, you know, pressing a button or the ballot box. There's a message there, and it's a message that's being carried not only in this country but elsewhere. So we better listen and pay attention and preserve our, you know, preserve our free societies.
Yes, well, I would concur with your observations about outside of the Eastern bubble.
Yeah.
After I retired, I took a trip around and I found a lot of people who would probably no more vote for a Democrat than they would rob a bank. To them, it was just a violation of civic norms.
Yeah.
well, my question goes to the Kavanaugh hearings and mainly the way they were covered. There was a great deal about the sexual assault, the alleged sexual assault, and so forth. But that seemed to obscure an awful lot of bad stuff about the man in terms of, and the way the process was being handled, where the suppression of 93 or 94% of his paper trail and all of the, basically, the political hack work. How did the media not get as inflamed about that and not press on that? It seemed to me that despite all the good intentions, that they were outgeneraled because they wound up fighting on a very familiar turf for the Republicans that they knew how to handle. Whereas the suppression of this man's record, it just struck me as such a violation of basic norms of democratic debate.
Yeah, suppression of his record, you know, he lied under oath. I mean, you could document that pretty much. I wrote a column and he revealed himself to be an injudicious, angry, somewhat unstable, troubled man, and that was, you know, very clear. Whatever you thought about the Blasey Ford case, that was very clear, and that was a very clear reason, and his perjury too, and that was a very clear reason by any standard. This is not a man you want sitting in judgment as in the highest court in the land for life. But you know, that did get obscured by, you know, was there corroboration or not? And in the end, it seems there was not. Although I found her. Personally, you know, I found her credible, and I didn't find him credible. I mean, again, this was not a criminal trial. I mean, had I been a juror, could I have convicted him beyond a reasonable doubt? No, I couldn't have. But I certainly concluded from the whole procedure and that he was not fit to sit on the Supreme Court. And, you know, but it's a thing, obviously, you know, when you've got a huge story, you know, there is a sort of lemming-like quality. You know, it was a huge dramatic story. It was a confrontation between these two people. It was live in your living room, you know, and it was, and every American was watching it, and or a huge number of Americans were watching it and drawing their own conclusions. So, I mean, I think we had editorials. You know, I thought our editorials were very good. You know, I thought in the New York Times, I mean, we pretty clearly made the point that he'd revealed himself to be unfit. But, you know, we don't always get everything right, and we don't always get the balance right. And journalists work under extreme pressure. You know, we work under pressure of deadlines And I think it's amazing what's been going on in the press now for the last nearly 2 years, because you have the New York Times and the Washington Post, the Post invigorated by Jeff Bezos' money, you know, really going mano a mano on a very, very big story with a very leaky administration. You know, that hermetic Obama administration, no drama, you know, that's gone. I mean, there are a lot of people in the administration, and we, of course, carried the anonymous piece, who are unhappy. So it's leaking, And I think people are realizing, why do we have a million new subscriptions? Because people are realizing, young Americans, all kinds of Americans are realizing that tough investigative journalism is very important to our freedoms. And it's not free. You know, you put somebody on that tax story, maybe for a year, you know, you're paying somebody's salary for, or more than one, but I mean, many people, and you produce a 14,000 word piece, you know, people are beginning to think, okay, well, you know, that's not free, right? And I think there's a very positive picture also in the press. Yeah.
I'd like to make a reference to actually a podcast in called The Hidden Brain, which talks about the physiology and how people behave and understand things. And there was just this week talking about red brain and blue brain and how there's a different perception probably in our brains and how we perceive things from seeing images and how you can do these studies that show how someone responds to an image can immediately tell whether they are conservative, liberal, et cetera. So that then speaks to then maybe
is this a new development? According to this theory, this is a new development that people have blue or red brains?
Well, I mean, neurologically, we can see these in functional MRIs, et cetera, along those lines, right?
Yeah.
So many times we then find ourselves talking until we're literally blue in the face, right? Blue. In the same language that a lot of people nod and understand.
Yeah.
And yet there's just a half of the population or whatever number that just don't see it the same way. It might be a white and gold dress or a blue and black dress, mm-hmm. you know, Yanni and Laurel. And it doesn't mean that it's wrong. It's just a different way of perceiving it. Mm-hmm. And so maybe that we are just talking among ourselves in a language that makes sense and obvious, whereas maybe we should be talking or writing in different ways that makes sense to other people in their perspective. You know, maybe speaking to fear about what might mean to them personally.
Yeah.
As opposed to, you know, speaking to the importance of empathy and acceptance.
Dismissiveness, contempt. I mean, again, people aren't persuaded by being made to feel stupid, you know, and they're not stupid. They're not stupid at all, many of them, and they have different ideas. So, yes, I mean, and I think a journalist's work, and all of our work to some degree, is to, I mean, the commons in American life has narrowed enormously. Where do you go to have those kinds of conversations? Well, you can't. I mean, and an experience like jury duty or something shows you that you can sit down with a bunch of people, and the first day one, you think, my God, I'll never agree on anything with these. And you know what? After 12 days or whatever, you know, you find a way, right? So it's not. So who here thinks they have a blue brain?
Right.
Red brain?
So
purple brain.
So we have to learn to talk in a language that makes sense.
Yeah,
it makes sense to maybe appeal to fear, maybe the emphasizing the fear of what it means to allow truth not to be truth. Mm-hmm. You know how it will affect you because you'll be so scared that this will affect you personally, and how you this is the real fear, not because of someone invading and taking over jobs or things
like
that.
A lot of the tendency in the country is in the opposite direction. I mean. Even at the New York Times, we, you know, among, I mean, there, when we open the opinion page, you know, when we hire a conservative columnist or we publish, you know, a piece questioning the Me Too movement or we, you know, we go against the liberal grain, you know. And I believe very strongly that our opinion pages should, we're a liberal newspaper, that's clear, but it's not very interesting to read the same thing all the time. It's interesting to hear and read other views. But I think there's a strong current in this country that there's this new verb, deplatform, you know, to deplatform people. Our goal should be to deplatform people. Well, deplatform is a grand word for silence. You know, we need to silence these people. You know, we're the resistance. We need to silence these people. They have no right to express their views. They're retrograde. Yeah, and I'm not talking about the lunatic fringe. I mean, I'm talking about what you just said. I mean, people who think very differently, you know, who feel that guns, their gun, is an essential part of their freedom as Americans. I mean, they went out as kids with their guns, and they've always lived with guns. And I mean, in fact, I went to a town in Colorado where there's an edict from the town council or whatever that makes it obligatory to own a gun. I don't think there's anybody going out, you know, checking this, but in theory, in this town nuclear, it is obligatory to own a gun. So, you know, that tells you there are people who think, and so I think deplatforming, silencing, you know, that current in American life is not good. And I think, as the gentleman over here said, you know, when you succumb to blind anger, you play into Trump's hands, because he is a pretty shrewd. I mean, he knows how to, you know, press people's buttons. He knows how to get people going. He has a pretty sharp antenna for the weaknesses of people in a very nasty, mean way very often. And so the temptation to succumb is there, but you know, I think we need to resist that. I mean, as a columnist, of course, you think, you know, am I just preaching to a choir? You know, does anybody who disagrees with me ever? You know, do people change their minds? You know, so you kind of live with that, but you always hope that maybe somewhere in this great country, somebody will read you and think again. Thank you.